Good morning.
Good morning.
Take a moment and welcome those next to you. Our order of worship this morning is Divine Service Setting 1 on page 151. We begin by singing hymn 797.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The introit is printed in the bulletin. Your testimonies are righteous forever.
Give me understanding that I may live.
Righteous are you, O Lord,
and right are your decrees.
You have appointed your testimonies in righteousness
and in all faithfulness.
My zeal consumes me,
because my soul is against your words.
Your promise is well tried,
and your servant loves it.
Your righteousness is righteous forever,
and your law is true. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Your testimonies are righteous forever. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, keep your church in your perpetual mercy, and because without you we cannot but fall, preserve us from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament readings for the 15th Sunday after Pentecost is from Amos chapter 8. Hear this, you who trample on the needy and bring the poor of the land to an end, saying, when will the new moon be over that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath that we may offer a wheat for sale, that we may make the ephah small and the shekel great, and deal deceitfully with false balances, that we may buy the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals and sell the chaff of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. epistle reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 2. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I am not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Likewise also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire, but with what is proper for women who profess godliness, with good works. Let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. For Adam was formed first, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. This is the word of the Lord. For the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 16th chapter. Jesus also said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. And he called him and said to him, what is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager. And the manager said to himself, what shall I do, since my master is taking the management away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am removed from management, people may receive me into their houses. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he said to the first, how much do you owe my master? He said, 100 measures of oil. He said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, how much do you owe? He said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness, for the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much, and one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. If then you have not been faithful in the unrighteous wealth, who will entrust you to the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. And the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, heard all these things, and they ridiculed him. And he said to them, you are those who justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. For what is exalted among men is an abomination in the sight of God. This is the gospel of the Lord. We make confession of our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven.
You may be seated when we sing hymn 819. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for this morning is the appointed psalm for the day, Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is light high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth? He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the dung heap to make them sit with princes, with the princes of his people. He gives the barren woman a home, making her the joyous mother of children. Praise the Lord. This is our text. Hi ho, hi ho. It's off to work we go. Maybe you remember that song from your childhood. The seven dwarfs sing this song as they finish work in the diamond mine. And what Walt Disney put into a cartoon in 1937 had long been part of various cultures around the world. The work song. Folklorists and ethnomusicologists. Those are people who study the music of different ethnic groups. They have long studied the way in which music has been associated with work. Railroad workers in the 1800s would spend their days laying the rails for the cross-country railroad. To do this, they would take 10-pound hammers and swing them in a full circle and strike the spike that would hold down the rails and ties. A work song would coordinate their labor. The rhythm of the song set the pace for the swinging of the hammer. The voices being joined united the workers. And the call and the response kept the workers engaged. This morning, we take a look at Psalm 113. It's a praise psalm, a hallel song, from which we get the word hallelujah, praise the Lord. It's one of a set of six psalms that were sung during the Passover. As Israel gathered to remember the Passover, they would sing Psalm 113 at the beginning of their celebration. And while technically it's not a work song because they weren't doing any work, it does show us some of the same things. It tells us how the psalm celebrates God's gracious work. How God graciously cares for his people, how he joins his people in praise as they serve in his kingdom. Yes, this psalm teaches us to celebrate God's gracious work. One of the intriguing things about work songs is that they join something that we often think is pleasurable, singing, with a difficult or menial task, work. We're accustomed to keeping the joy of singing and the struggle of work separate, but work songs join the two together. And in a similar way, our psalm joins together two things that we tend to keep separate. On the one hand, we have the utter transcendence of God. He's up there. He's in charge. He can see everything. As we listen to the opening of the psalm, we realize just how utterly other God is, how exalted he is, how high he is above us poor little creatures. The Lord is enthroned in eternity. Time passes in our world. Kings and rulers come and go. As we've witnessed with the passing of Queen Elizabeth. But the Lord is seated in the heavenly realms, and his rule never began and never ends. It just always is. And not only is the Lord ruling in eternity, but his rule extends over all space, not just this little earth, but the heavens above, the whole universe is his. From the east to the west, from the north to the south, the Lord is in control. There is no space over which he has no control. And then on the other hand, we have the utter nearness of God. He's way up there, but he's also right here with us. God, who is seated above the heavens and the earth, is also able to see the smallest little thing on earth. He is able to care for the poor and the needy, those who gather their food from trash heaps. Those are the ones that this Almighty God notices. The people whose lives pass by and leave no mark on the world are the ones that God marks and claims as his own. The psalmist calls us to praise the Lord, and indeed we should praise him. Out of his gracious love, the Lord of all things chose to become one of us, to become man, to come into this world, and to die on the cross for you. Jesus Christ, true God, becomes true man so that he might bear the suffering of all, carry all of our sins for you and me. He might take the suffering that we deserve on his back. And he brings to us the joy of our salvation. Jesus joins that joy, the joy of the song of salvation, to the painful burdens that we carry on this earth, the suffering that we endure in this world. We are chosen by God. There is no person so small, no sin so great or so hidden that Jesus did not take it upon himself and carry it to the cross for you. And in its place, he gives you the grace of God, the forgiveness of your sins, and life everlasting. Psalm 113 guides our work in God's kingdom. Like work songs, it builds and strengthens the bonds of community. By offering a rhythm of work, by joining the voices of workers, by lifting the spirits of those who are burdened, work songs forge bonds between workers as they do what they have been called to do. And our psalm invites us to be a part of God's community of faith. And one of the interesting things about this psalm is that it takes one small incident from the scriptures and it incorporates it into a yearly celebration of the Passover. Now, if you were to list all of the memorable events of scripture, what would you include? Well, we'd definitely include the suffering and death and resurrection of Jesus. And if we give it enough thought, we might include creation, the fall, Noah's Ark, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Moses and the Red Sea, David and Goliath, or Daniel and the lion's den. But you probably wouldn't include Hannah and the gift of her son, Samuel. As you think about the major events of Scripture, even though Samuel was a prophet, the story of Hannah just doesn't make the list. Hannah was one of Elkanah's two wives. She was the barren one, not having children caused her great distress. And once when she was in the temple praying to God about this, the priest saw how upset she was and accused her of being drunk. But Hannah was pouring out her heart and soul to the Lord. And though her husband did not hear her, though the priest did not understand her, the Lord heard, understood, and answered her prayer. And upon receiving her child Samuel, Hannah sings a song of praise to the Lord. My heart exults in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. There is none holy like the Lord, for there is none besides you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread. Those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and he exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on him he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness. For not by might shall a man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Against them he will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give you strength to his king and exalt the horn of the anointed. That's Hannah's song from 2 Samuel chapter 1. And one small line from that song is in our psalm today. The Lord raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. From the song of one of the minor characters in Scripture comes a confession of faith in God. And God causes this song from this insignificant person to be heard in all Israel. And Israel began to join in singing her song. One small work of God becomes something that joins God's people together as they saw how he works in the smallest ways to extend his gracious care to his people. In our readings today, we see how often the church has forgotten this song. In Amos, we overhear God's people singing a song of self-service. They are ignoring the poor and the needy. In the gospel, we hear the religious leaders singing a song of greed. They too are ignoring the poor and the needy. This psalm is given to God's people to change our way of living in the world. Rather than live for ourselves, we join together in our Lord's mission and care for others. For not only has Christ redeemed you and me from our sin, he has joined us together as a people who live in a kingdom where he loves. There are no insignificant members of this community of faith. We bear one another's burdens, and thus we fulfill the law of the Lord. And while Luther is not an ethnomusicologist, he does pick up a little bit on understanding the value of song as God's people work. In the small catechism, Luther teaches people to pray in the morning. He encourages them after finishing their prayers to go joyfully to your work, singing a hymn like that of the Ten Commandments or whatever your devotion may suggest. And in the same way, Psalm 113 is a song of service in God's kingdom. The psalm begins by turning our attention to God. We praise him for his rule over all things. But then we begin to see more clearly the tenderness, the care of his gracious work. He comes to care for the lowly and the needy. And as we sing God's praise, we are led into God's service. That is still true today, as it was 2,000 years ago or 4,000 years ago. We are God's people. We sing his praise and he leads us into service. We may not know where. We may not even know that we're doing something in his service. But God's gracious care guides us as we serve in his kingdom. And he causes his gospel to be known through you and me. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the gathering of the offering. Rise and sing the offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble and hearty thanks for all the goodness and loving kindness that you bestow on us. We praise you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, we bless you for your boundless love in the redemption of the world by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. We implore you to give us a right understanding of all your mercies, that our hearts may ever be deeply thankful, and that we may show forth your praise with both our lips and our lives. Direct our lives in ways of holiness and righteousness all our days, that we may enjoy the testimony of a good conscience and the hope of your favor. Be sustained and comforted in every time of trouble, and finally be received into your everlasting kingdom through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, that fulfilling your law and gaining for you a proper people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those you created, and have sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had blessed it, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
us pray. O gracious God, our heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Our closing hymn is number 794. Just one last announcement. 2 weeks from yesterday, on the 1st of October, we're going to have another work day at the cemetery. Plan starting around 8, so that'll be the last one this year. So if you would have a few hours to spare out, we'd really appreciate it. Any questions, just let somebody, one of the trustees know. We want to thank those who showed up yesterday for the work that was done. Have a blessed week, and we'll see you all next Sunday. Have a good time at the fair, but not too good a time.